Imagine a single grain of sand. It is so small you can barely focus on it. Now, an atom, the basic building block of matter, is 10 million times smaller. You may ask, how could we possibly know that an object so small exists? How did we even develop theories relating to matter and elements? Well, it took hundreds of years of research from people all over the world who slowly developed and utilized the scientific method to create the foundation of modern chemistry. In this video, we will discuss the origins of some principles of modern chemistry relating to matter and atoms. Let's start by going back to 400 BC. At that time, there were no light bulbs, no windows, and no Netflix. The conventional wisdom was that all matter was made up of water, earth, fire, and air. However, the philosopher Democritus posed some key questions. For example, he asked, is matter infinite or is it composed of small particles that cannot be separated? He referred to these indivisible particles as atoms, but there was no way for him to test his idea that matter consists of indivisible particles. For the next 1800 years, chemistry was dominated by alchemy. Alchemy did not follow the scientific method. Rather than performing evidence-based experiments, science and theology were often combined, and research was usually guided by beliefs. Many alchemists wished to discover an elixir for eternal life, transform cheap metals like lead into gold, or create a drug that could treat all illnesses. However, much like the Philosopher's Stone from Harry Potter, these goals were ultimately fantasy. Nevertheless, during the era of alchemy, many new elements like bismuth, iron, carbon, and platinum were discovered, and the theory that matter was only made up of water, earth, fire, and air was disproved. An important figure in the transition from alchemy to modern chemistry was Robert Boyle, who lived from 1627 to 1691. He was a proponent of the theory that elements are the primary, undecomposable components of matter, and that there is a difference between mixtures and compounds. While Boyle was also an alchemist who hoped to transmute metals, he was able to create important theories because he started to move chemistry to a quantitative science where known amounts of materials are used. Quantitative experiments are a hallmark of how scientists perform chemistry today. Now, Anton Lavoisier is widely regarded as one of the first modern chemists and the father of chemistry because he eschewed alchemy and is most closely associated with the shift of chemistry from qualitative to quantitative. Among his many notable discoveries were his proposal of the law of conservation of mass, which states that mass is neither created nor destroyed. So, when you are doing a chemical reaction, if you put 100 grams of reactants in, you must get 100 grams of products out. Unfortunately, sometimes it is hard to find all 100 grams of product, for example, when reactions generate a gas. A contemporary of Lavoisier was Joseph Proust, who developed the law of definite proportions. This law states that a given compound always contains exactly the same proportion of elements by mass. For example, every molecule of water, H2O, is always 16 parts O to 2 parts H by mass, so the mass ratio of O to H is 8 to 1. No matter how much or how little water you have, the water will always be 11.19% hydrogen and 88.81% oxygen by mass. This law is important because it suggests that the composition of water is always constant. The work of Boyle Lavoisier, Proust, and many other scientists not mentioned in this video set the stage for John Dalton to develop the law of multiple proportions. This applies to series of compounds that consist of only two elements. For instance, let's look at two compounds that only contain carbon and oxygen. In our first compound, carbon monoxide, when there is 1 gram of carbon, there will be 1.33 grams of oxygen. In our second compound, carbon dioxide, when there is 1 gram of carbon, there will be 2.66 grams of oxygen. What do you notice about the amount of oxygen in the two compounds? The ratio of the mass of oxygen in the two compounds is 2 to 1. This is predicted by the law of multiple proportions that says when two elements form a series of compounds, the ratios of the masses of the second element that combine with 1 gram of the first element can always be reduced to small whole numbers. So, as in our example, if one compound has the formula CO, then we find a new compound with twice as much oxygen, we know it must be CO2. Like the law of definite proportions, the law of multiple proportions is consistent with compounds always being made of a fixed number of atoms. The law of multiple proportions may have inspired Dalton to develop the theory of atoms, which is his most important contribution and was published in 1808. The theory of atoms is based on four premises. 1. All elements are composed of atoms. 2. All atoms of a given element are identical, but different elements have different atoms. 3. Chemical compounds are formed when atoms combine, and a given compound should always contain the same combination of these atoms. So water, H2O, will always contain 2 hydrogen atoms and 1 oxygen atom. 4. Chemical reactions change how atoms are bonded to one another, not the identities of the atoms. So, when we react hydrogen, H2, and oxygen, O2, to form water, H2O, the atoms hydrogen and oxygen are not changed. But in the reactants, hydrogen is bonded to hydrogen and oxygen to oxygen, but in the product, hydrogen is bonded to oxygen. All 4 of these premises have been shown to be true and form the basis for modern chemistry. Let's summarize. From around 400 BC to 1800, we moved from believing that all matter was made up of earth, air, fire, and water, to a theory based on matter consisting of atoms. In 1800, we knew of about 30 different elements, but today we know of 118, all composed of different atoms from each other. This video only lists a handful of the contributors to the development of theories relating to matter and atoms. It presents progress as linear rather than encompassing all the complicated and nuanced nature of scientific discovery. In reality, theories and ideologies emerged and were disputed, with many being disproved. Sometimes we go backwards to go forwards. This is important because even today, each new scientific theory that we prove or refute is done so based in part on the discovery of those who have come before us. Only working together can we make scientific discoveries that advance society and our understanding.